All right, let's hit record. Everybody? All right, let's hit record in the studio. All right, we're live. Are you recording? Recording? Okay, all right. Oh, yeah. Black Sun in the Hizzle. Oh, for Shizzle Dizzle. We got an excellent show here today. Before someone say the views and opinions that of the arena does not reflect that of Comcast and staff or affiliates. And the views of Black Sun does not reflect that of the arena. We are a council. And the views are what, let me see, watch, son. I represent the good old boys. Never meaning no harm.
Why?
But y'all, you never saw what the, oh, I'm sorry.
Quiet power.
Okay.
Let's get to our right. Okay, y'all. To my right, introduce yourself, Sabukwe.
I'm Sabukwe Sikora, a member of the All African People's Revolutionary Party. And also do a program on Radio Free Georgia called RAP, Revolutionary African Perspectives.
Okay.
And I am Kevin Karen. I'm glad to be back. Spookwe is a friend of mine. I've learned a lot from listening to his show on WRFG, Revolutionary African Perspectives. I also have a show right before that I help out with, Just Peace.
I'm Marlon. I've been on the show a few times talking about police, white supremacy, and anarchism.
Abiz, your brother, back here, Gideon Ben Yasharal, servant of Yah, and a servant in the arena, Uncensored.
Hello and welcome. Thank you for tuning in. I am your co-host, Vincent Cheeks, aka Ghetto Messiah.
Ghetto
entertainer, activist. I have one announcement to make before we get into our topic today. You will soon be able to find me on WCEGtalkradio.com as of early October, Tuesdays from 6 to 8 p.m. That is WCEGtalkradio.com.
Can I make an announcement as well?
Please make an announcement.
Thank
Kevin.
You very much. I want to let everybody know that given what topic we're going to be discussing today, Zionism and whatnot, this coming weekend right here in Atlanta, the U.S. campaign to end the Israeli occupation will be having its 14th annual conference. It's going to be right here in Atlanta. The conference begins on Friday, September 25th at 4 p.m. We'll go until Sunday, the 27th, 7 p.m. Our own DAWN Gibson will be doing a panel on Sunday. DAWN will be doing that panel talking about police brutality and the connection between these Israeli and U.S. police exchanges. So some of that information will be interesting. But wanted to let everybody know about that conference.
Is there somewhere people can go to get information on it, a website or anything?
People can go to, it's end the campaign to endtheoccupation.org. So I think you just type in endtheoccupation.org and you can get more information on the conference and what they're all about. But that's going to be right here in Atlanta. And Blackson, I know I talked to you. Maybe we'll be able to get in there with a camera. We'll see.
Man, if we can, that'd be great. I definitely want to document.
Big ups to Yanga and NKrumah.
Yeah.
Shout out to Yanga. What's up, my brother?
Yes, sir.
Thank you very much, Kevin, for that announcement. All right. Let's jump into today's topic, which is Zionism. We're going to talk about a little anarchy as well. And some other things. You know how we do on the arena. We be all over the place. Okay.
No, Gideon be all over the place.
No, I mean without.
Quiet power.
I mean with the topics. He just, you know how he is. Okay, Zionism. What is Zionism? It is a nationalist and political movement of Jews and Jewish culture that supports the reestablishment of a Jewish homeland in the territory defined as the historic land of Israel. Zionism emerged in the late 19th century in Central and Eastern Europe as a national revival movement called Hovivo Zion. Hope I said that right. And soon after this, most leaders of the movement associated the main goal with creating the desired state in Palestine, then controlled by the Ottoman Empire. And so Zionists, they have their advocates, they have their critics. So I guess we're gonna find out today what side of the panel is on. So Zionism, is it a good thing or a bad thing? They've been connected to the Illuminati. As a matter of fact, from what I read today, they're supposed to be the head of the Illuminati.
The Illuminati.
Right.
Boy.
So that's conspiracy, right. But
I agree.
It has been stated that the Zionists not only run Israel, but America as well, because they have infiltrated the ranks of politics and government and all other things. So, who wants to jump in here and discuss Zionism with me?
Well, let's let our guest.
If I was to start, first of all, I think that Zionism is more than this. It's a political movement, first and foremost.
Okay.
And unfortunately, it's a political movement that hides behind a religion called Judaism. But it is not a religion at all. It is a political imperialist force, a Zionist force. The Zionism was its first founder, one of its founders, is a man by the name of Theodore Herzl.
Correct.
Theodore Herzl was an atheist. He did not believe in God.
So wait a minute, what's wrong with being an atheist?
I'm not saying anything is wrong with being an atheist. Okay. But can an atheist find a religious movement?
Right, correct. And to your point,
to finish that out for anybody who wants to check, all you have to do is look for the complete diary of Theodore Herzl, and he himself says he's an atheist. Not only that, for us, I just want to be clear that for African people, Zionism is indeed an enemy of African people.
Correct. And, it is a racist.
It's racist, and it starts in terms of building itself. Its first, one of its first political relationships is with beginning of the settler colonialist society that we knew as apartheid South Africa. Before apartheid existed, when the settlers of the Afrikaners finally won its independence from Britain as a settler colony, it immediately aligned itself with Zionists and the Zionist movement under the second leader of the Zionist movement by a man by the name of Weissman. So we know, and in this Weissman book, you can check it out, a book called Weissman and Smuts, where they exchanged letters and they talked about them controlling Africa from Zionism and Israel controlling it from the north and South Africa controlling it from the south. These relationships, it was a political movement, it has been a political movement, and it will always be a political movement. And in fact, the question of, when Theodore Herzl and them were offered a place in Africa, not Palestine.
Uganda.
Uganda.
That's what they tried to do first.
It was actually Kenya. It's a mistake that record when they said it was Uganda, but it's actually a part of what is
they
modern
today is Kenya, right?
It's modern day Kenya. The Herzl first acted like he was going to reject it, but if you look in his diary, you will also find out, and you look at later the second year after it was offered, they turned around and said that we will take the land that you've offered us in Africa.
Right, and to your point, I did read a statement that said an essential goal of the Zionists was and is to change the nature of the Jewish movement from that of a religious entity to a political movement, to your
yeah,
point.
Yeah, exactly. And you can actually see the trajectory of Jewish people as a people that understood themselves from before Israel into the Zionist struggle. Before the existence of Israel, many of Jewish people in the Jewish diaspora felt that diaspora was the proper way to exist.
Right.
They were against the idea of the formation of a state, religious
state, right,
or otherwise.
I read that.
But that Jewish identity has mostly been erased with the establishment of Israel and its claim to be the Jewish homeland, the place for all Jews and for nobody else.
And if we want to be accurate, actually, even now, the majority of Jews in the world are not Zionists,
right,
and they
right
don't support Zionism. It is the propaganda machine that Zionism controls that has allowed us to think that most of the Jews in the world are Zionists. Just like most of the Jews are not in Europe, there are a lot of Jews in other places in the
right
world, including Africa, and even at the time of Palestine's occupation under the Ottoman Empire,
right,
and later under Britain,
they had 24,000 Jews.
There were plenty of Jews and then Palestine who lived
right
alongside with the other so-called Arabs,
Arabs,
but really the Palestinians that we call over there.
Correct. I have a question because I didn't find this out till I was doing the research. Because I thought Judaism and Zionism were basically one and the same. But now, like you just stated, I found out that most Jewish people are against Zionism. Is that correct?
There's a great number of Jews that are against Zionism. You can even find the Jews, and you'll go in New York, you'll find the Jews that we know to our traditional Jews are against Zionism. Because many Jews believe that the return to Zion is not a question of a physical geographic change. But a religious spiritual return, similar to what people think about the last days or the return of Jesus Christ. Those kinds of constructs are not about the takeover of any physical land on the plane of the living, so to speak.
But who in their right mind would want to establish their religious beliefs or any type of theocratic structure in the government anyways? I mean, I understand the ridicule of Zionism, but I would...
Well, it's because religion has been known to be a motivator of people. People kill in the name of their religion and their beliefs.
Well, absolutely, right.
Mm-hmm. So
right.
The question of hiding it, it's just like when the settler, because as we know, Israel, the settler state of Israel is the same as the United States. Mm-hmm. And the United States hid its treachery behind the question of manifest destiny, mm-hmm. a Christian concept. Mm-hmm. That somehow that God had needed them to go around the world, slaughter people, and turn them into Christians.
So why not eliminate the whole theocracy, like Stalin did? Just burn the Bibles and the Qurans, because when you have evidence there saying, like in the Quran, it says, behead the infidels. Mm-hmm. Your evidence is right there. So when you take that in the court of law, Muslims might scream left and right, well, no, we're a peaceful religion. No, but your book says to kill unbelievers right there. So I say the evidence is clear. Well, when God says, and we got a fanatic right there, named Gideon.
Wow. Don't you talk about my elder like that, bro.
When you have the proof and evidence, the Bible, like it clearly says, stone an adulterous woman. Clear, there's no, people argue about interpretations, it really means this. No, it means if you catch that woman cheating, stone her, mm-hmm. behead her, put her under a tank and crush her. Clearly it says that. And so if you bring that in the court of law, your evidence is clear and cut. So I say eliminate the religious application of religious ideology, period, to begin with. Last week we just talked about, what's her name that was against gay marriage?
Davis.
Right, so
Davis, yeah.
My thing is, why don't we start a new form of government? That's kind of why I agree with Marlon on the whole anarchy thing. I say we start from the scratch, because nowhere is the African, nowhere is the Palestinian, or anybody, the Arab, offering a better solution. You know what I'm saying? They ridicule Zionism, they ridicule American imperialism. Go ahead, Kevin, because I'm just...
Well, I just want to make the point that, start from scratch. What do you expect people to do? You expect people to take religious ideas or, things that have been part of their family for generations, mm-hmm. And then just throw it away? I mean, there are a lot of good things that come out of religion, too. Religion is a mixed bag sort of kind of deal in that I was raised Catholic, and I can tell you plenty of things about being raised, and I'd also say I was raised Irish Catholic. I have Irish ancestry. Mm-hmm. They left Ireland during the potato famine, and they came to the U.S. And when they came to the U.S., they became part of the settler colonialist class and went off to war and fought Mexico and claimed land here in the U.S. and were supported by a state. And they did that because religion was a great way to get people to say, hey, you are one of us, and we need to get rid of them.
And Kevin, I'm glad you brought up Ireland.
Because it's a settler colony.
Not only that, but Ireland has just legalized gay marriage.
Yes.
Uh-huh. And a lot of, a lot of conservative, which is a small, minute part of Ireland, they had a small Catholic pushback. And you had, Irish people saying, look, man, this is our human rights.
As I disagree that for some reason, that I might have a human right that prevents two people from getting married or doing something together.
No. The people that were for the gay marriage were saying, we have a human right.
Well, yeah, absolutely.
Right, because the argument for the gay marriage, whether it be in Ireland or here in America or anywhere, is that it's a human right.
Sure.
And my argument is that human rights trumps your beliefs, his beliefs, my beliefs, because it's a belief. A human right. A person's belief should not trump a person's human right.
So just in the context of that, and I don't know how long we're going to stay in this arena. But I'm just saying, in terms of the question, that wasn't a pun, but anyway.
It's a good one.
But in the question of, because you started with the question of religion, and then you talked about human rights. But I think and then you talked about the Soviet Union. I think we should be clear.
Okay.
Religion itself, to me, is a human right.
Okay.
People believe in their spirit, their spiritual beliefs.
All right,
and
right.
Even in countries that practice, because there is no country that practiced communism, but when the Soviet Union was the Union of Socialist Republics, we go to Cuba, we go to other socialist states, religion has never been forbidden in any of these places. Religion is protected as a social right. Religions are only...
I'm sorry, I meant to say China, I'm sorry.
Even in China, you know, it's not like religious institutions cannot exist.
Right. It just can't be a part of the government.
Right, because even to guarantee people's religious, in most places in the world today, to protect the people's religious rights, if the state chooses a religion, it would be suppressing another religion.
Because,
So all religions have to have equal protection under the state.
Agreed.
So the religion, the state can't choose a religion. That's not, but it should not, it should not destroy religion. It only should make sure that no religion oppresses another group of people within the institutions. And in some cases, institutions religious institutions have collaborated with foreign governments to try to overthrow a government within the society, and then they have to be repressed. That's what happened with the Catholics. Initially, Catholics in Cuba were trying to undermine the Cuban government coming to power. Mm-hmm. So certainly they had to suppress their activity in that sense. But certainly the people being able to go out and express their spiritual beliefs mm-hmm. should be a right. And just as atheism, of course, should be a right
Absolutely.
Within every society. Certainly, atheism is just as legitimate in my mind as any as spiritualism, because we as human beings have no way to substantiate either the existence or the non-existence of God.
I love it, Marlon.
But I think we got to be careful about overemphasizing religion within the context of any of these. Of any of these conflicts, whether we're talking about Zionism or other forms of oppression, I find that most of the time, when you look for the actual root of oppression and inequality, you don't find religion at the bottom. You find some material conditions.
I agree.
And religion is often used as the cover for it.
Absolutely.
Right? So, for example, Europeans in America did not actually colonize the New World because they thought that God wanted them to.
Exactly.
They colonized the New World because they wanted the New World, and then they explained it with this cover story about God wants us.
Exactly.
Right? They didn't enslave Africans because they really thought that their religion told them that. It was because they could get free money and labor, and then they explained it with their religion.
Right.
And I think even if they had had a different religion, or even if they had had no religion at all, they would have come up with a story to justify what they were doing.
Right.
And so, therefore, I don't want to put too much blame on the religion itself, because distracts from the actual underlying conditions that cause people to do these.
Which is psychotic behavior.
That's important in taking us back, but I'll let you were...
No, I want Elder Gideon to jump in here. Okay.
Well, peace and blessings. It's first, as a Jew and a Zionist, the concept itself has a reflection of dimensions.
Wait. Did you just say you were a Jew and a Zionist?
Absolutely.
He said it.
I was confused.
Absolutely. And I'm a Messianic Jew. And this is the issue because...
I I told you he was a fanatic. Go ahead.
Man, this panel is powerful. Just such intellects. But the problem with the so-called Negro born in America and their understanding of historical biblical fact has its relevance in certain time periods. The time before the incursion of what we now call the white Jews, the Sephardic, or the people who controlled the land now and went in 1948, there was a history that predated them where the Jewish, or the Jew, the people that are called Jews, the concept of Zionism is based on the culture of the Creator who gave Abraham, who begot Isaac, and Isaac who begot Jacob, and the 12 children.
We got an hour show. Don't do all this begetting.
Yeah. well, we do a lot of begetting. No word. We love
right. Women.
But the point is, Zionism and Judaism are unified in the concept of the original covenants that were made with Yah's holy people, who are called the Hebrew Israelites, the Hebrews, or the people who are indigenous to that land.
Gideon, Zabukwe is saying you're making the same argument as this atheist.
But okay,
so thank you.
Well, I wanted to kind of jump in and make one point. So when I read or listen to some Jewish scholars who are opposed to the state of Israel and what, and even the creation of the state of Israel,
okay,
what they'll say, and I'm specifically talking about like Noam Chomsky, for example, someone like that. He said, if you were to ask my parents when they were around, if they were Zionists, they would have said yes, because at the time the word Zionist meant to reconstruct the culture and reconstruct the type of community and things like that.
Right, exactly.
There was never anything about a state. And I think what we're gonna, what we're kind of discussing today is the UN resolution that said Zionism was equivalent to racism that was passed in 1975, which Sibukwe made me aware of, is talking about the redefinition, the redefining of Zionism. Mm-hmm. So the Zionists, and Theodor Herzl being one of them, knew that if you could connect something called Zionism that meant reconstructing culture and stuff,
right,
and instead turn it into an argument for developing a settler colony, mm-hmm, where white people, white Jews, would go in,
right,
and take land from Palestinians, mm-hmm, and redefine Zionism in that way, because right, Noam Chomsky also says, today, my parents would call themselves staunch anti-Zionists.
Right, okay.
Because the Zionist movement is about reclaiming, or not reclaiming, but stealing land that
right,
was never there.
Well, it has
right,
been co-opted, because let me understand and explain, because I went through the Aliyah process. The Aliyah process is a concept.
That is the Jewish migration. Right?
That is the Jewish okay, migration, the Zionist concept of if a person considers himself a Jew, that they can repatriate to the land. It, for so-called Negroes, I'm sorry, blacks, I'm sorry, coloreds, I'm sorry, African-Americans, I'm sorry, you know, the our people who have are the original Jews, because we don't understand who we are, we look at the concept that has the cover story, which was brilliant observation. They use the cover of the term Zionism as a political movement to create this agenda to take land from people who were indigenous, who our people had already been displaced in 70 AD under Antiochus Epiphanes, when the Roman went in and sacrificed the sow on Yah's altar, that our people, the Jews, were banned from Jerusalem, the true Jews. So what we have to do is look through the prism of white supremacy, colonization, and the redefining, as we use the term gay, we find it in the Bible, we find it where the president on the Potomac River said the gay president and his wife, and now it has been redefined as a sexual lifestyle. This redefining of terminology is the key element as we use etymology to go back to the root, and we find who the true Jews are, what the true term Zionism means, and who are the true Zionists.
Let me ask you a question, because you keep using the term true Jew,
yes, sir,
correct?
Absolutely.
And you stated that the true Jews are Negroes, African Americans.
They are black.
They are black, right?
But beautiful.
And so I have a quote and then a question.
Mm-hmm.
Because the second president of Egypt, Gamal Abdel Nasser,
mm-hmm,
he said to the current Jews,
right,
You will never be able to live here in peace because you left here black and came back white.
Exactly.
So my question is,
absolutely,
how did this mix up happen?
Well, the creator, Yah himself, and through the power of the universe and his anointed son, Yeshua, because of the disobedience of the mighty and the holy people, from turning from our original culture to following the ways of our oppressors, punished us by ousting us from the land. Just like a man divorces his wife because
you done made black man.
Well, this is the point.
This is a belief, right?
No, this is actual fact. 1948 is when the people that we call Jews went into the land.
Okay,
what you asked was, how did it happen? And what I'm telling you is, the creator moved
his people. Okay, the creator is a belief. Hold on.
Well, that's a belief.
And let me ask a question. I don't want to turn this into a religious show.
Okay? Right.
I'm getting nauseous right now. How did the UN determine this as racism, Zion? Like, what made it?
Well, there's quite a bit of evidence here, but I'd actually like to ask Sabukwe if you could share some of, because your understanding involves a number of meetings that took place, correct?
Yeah. I think it's clearly understood. Again, when I said in the beginning, this whole question that it was a part of a colonial project.
Okay. Right.
We got to know that the first Zionist conference was held in Basel, Switzerland in 1897.
Okay.
In the midst of the period in which colonization was going on in the world, the grab of Europe and Japan of the rest of the world, the taking over of the and controlling, the colonizing,
resources,
the taking over of the resources of the world, so taking over the existing nations and countries and spots around the world from Africa to the Western Hemisphere to Asia, everywhere this colonization process was going on. Mm-hmm. Zionism political Zionism pushed itself into that process.
Right.
So it was clear for many people that Zionism was equating itself with Britain. It was even talking back and forth to the Turkish Empire, the Ottoman Empire, trying to insert itself as a colonial process. Mm-hmm. It was a colonial process. Now it was clear to those who were fighting against colonialism in Africa, in Latin America, and in Asia, that they were on the side of colonialism. Mm-hmm. So we see that as they are struggling and they're having their conferences, the International Women's Conference in the Tricontinental Conference that took place in Cuba in 1965, that led to the forming of the OSPAL, the solidarity movement between Asia, Africa, and Latin America. They were already talking about support of the Palestinians against the colonial process. So by 1975, you have all of the political organizations that have emerged that are fighting colonialism, the Non-Aligned Movement, Organization of African Unity, all the women's international movements, all understanding what are their enemies. The enemies of colonialism, settler colonialism, neocolonialism, racism, and sexism. These are the enemies that they are able to define. So by the 1975, there's a major meeting in Mexico of an international women's meeting that declares that Zionism is one of the enemies of the people of the world. There's the Non-Aligned meeting that meets that same year and declares that it is Zionism is an enemy of the people. Organization of African Unity now is calling Israel part of the unholy alliance,
right?
Because it is based, it has a direct relationship, is arming and training and helping South Africa continue to exist and Zimbabwe, so the road which was called Rhodesia at that time.
Right.
So the OAU is standing up saying that these racist institutions that are actually saying that their people are superior to the indigenous populations, are enemies of humanity. If you are going to go by your own documents that were created, the position on human rights and the position on racism in the UN, they use all of those documents. and all of those positions that had already been passed in the UN on the, what was racism in the world, what was oppressive in the world, and they said, okay, look, this sounds just like Zionism. Right. Zionism then, therefore, is racism. And so, that resolution is, that's how the resolution was be able to be passed.
Well, but they repealed that in 1991.
Huh?
They repealed that in 1991.
Yeah.
Saying that it's not a racist.
Right. And also, see, there's a difference between what you have to do when you look at historically, you have to look at the Herodians. Herod was a king who was tetrarch in Galilee, but he was a vassal king for Rome. What we find is this is the displacement of the original people and people who were put in power to usurp the original people's authority in the land. And then when we talk about our ancestry and how we were colonized, again, there is a difference between political Zionism and spiritual Zionism. And I think you very well defined that with your historical accounts of how the colonialists used, and Kevin also mentioned that as well as Marlon, they used these religious cultural terms as a cover for their political agenda to take land and resources. So what we find is Zionism in and of itself, racism is not a bad word. It's been made into a bad word. Bad word is bigotry
and hatred. What Zubukwe mentioned and what I was listening for, and I caught it, is that the indigenous people use the human rights to define and see the inequality. Because if you just go on religious doctrine alone, the Bible and the Quran, the Torah and the Key, all these religious books justify a hierarchy. And you know, Marlon, we discussed the hierarchy on the show about anarchy before. You have people sliding in Zionism when they disrupt structures. I'm sure because most indigenous structures have a council. Mm-hmm. So if you could pull off one person and pay him, you can disrupt the whole governmental structure. That's number one. Mm-hmm. Number two, you paint to the people that there is, this class over here is educated, this class here is the ghetto. You know what I'm saying? So you have the indoctrination, but the human rights knocks that out. It's just like when you said that your God mm-hmm. believes that man and man is an abomination. Mm-hmm. That's what your Bible said. That's what all the religious people believe, okay? Human rights says, no, they have a right. Now, you said last week, Vince asked you straight up, do the homosexuals rape? You said, absolutely not, based on your belief. That's why I said human rights trumps anybody's belief. Now, Zubukwe, I agree. The religion is a human right, but if I say, you know, I have a right to my religion, I'm going to circumcise my wife. I don't have a right to infringe on her rights. So as long as your religious right, you can be religious. More. I have a pink unicorn out of card that I believe in. As long as that pink unicorn doesn't harm anybody on this table, then I have a right to my religion. But the minute I say, you know what, I'm going to circumcise my wife and my daughter, it's infringing on that person's human rights. Gideon.
Well, so that's how they recognize between it. Human rights and cultural imperatives.
No. But it should not infringe on nobody's human rights.
The term human rights is a modern term that reflects a humanist concept that has trumped cultural directives that are ancient in their origin. In your opinion, sir?
No, as a fact. In your cultural belief, mm-hmm. you believe your Bible said that you can sell women for two certainly. Goats and a cow.
Yes.
Okay. So no, if you bring that before me, mm-hmm. I'm going to overthrow your government.
Well,
because you're infringing on their human rights.
And when you look at this system and how women have the right.
And they should
men,
have a right.
Men have no right to their own seed that comes from their body. And when they get ready to, when the child is produced, they have to go to a court system that doesn't give them any authority. What's the difference? Vince, so you will support that.
I'm going to let you take that, Vince.
I want to throw something
come
in here.
Come on, Marlon.
Talking about.
Get them back on point.
Talking about African people, black people in Israel, or Zionist black people.
Yes.
I learned recently this year. About what's going on with Ethiopian Jews in Israel.
Yes.
That's right.
Because there's a significant population.
Absolutely.
These are black-skinned people. They're Jewish. They consider themselves part of Israel. I think maybe less than 8% of the population.
Yes.
more than 40% of the prison population.
That's right.
Absolutely.
In Israel?
Yes.
In Israel.
Yes.
Not just that. Well, yeah.
No, finish, please.
Yes. Well, and so the reason that I learned about it is right. because there developed a serious movement in May of this year of people of Ethiopian Jews who felt that they're being repressed.
I did hear about that. I heard about that.
Widespread rioting, yes. widespread rebellion right. against yeah, yeah, the Israeli yeah. government.
And these are Jews, these are not Palestinians. And a friend of mine was actually locked up in Israeli jails, and she did a head count, and she was saying it was mostly Ethiopian, Somalian women. Shout out to Cynthia McKinney, who was locked up for 2 weeks mm-hmm. in Israel jail.
Mm-hmm. Not to mention that actually, right, the question of Africans, people of African descent,
yes,
right,
people who look like us,
right,
yes,
yeah, that in Israel and the occupied Palestine, the question of the Sudanese and the Eritreans,
yes,
who have arrived out there because of repression or as refugees,
right.
They've been locked up some of them locked up in camps on the desert.
Right.
We talk about this refugee crisis right now.
That's right.
Israel has taken less than out of thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of refugees seeking any kind of cover. Asylum in Israel. They have taken absolutely less than 1% of 1%. Mm-hmm. About 4 or 5 people have cut the mustard mm-hmm. in terms of, of their
yes.
They're trying to starve these people
yes.
and right. put them out on the desert so they'll return so that they'll try to trek back away from it.
Absolutely.
The racism and they have attacked these
bigotry.
They've attacked them in the cities. They've attacked the Ethiopians who they used as cannon fodder
yes.
in between the struggle between mm-hmm. the Palestinians
yes.
and the Zionists. So they have never, and they have a tremendously ugly record with Africa. That's why I keep going back to it. Mm-hmm. Even coming back to understanding here, the Zionist lobby here, that is mostly is not fully represented, but mm-hmm. one of their biggest advocates is what we call AIPAC.
Mm-hmm. AIPAC,
which is the American Israeli, what is it? The AIPAC has targeted Cynthia McKinney right here.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Put thousands and thousands, called out to the other organizations, Zionist controlled organizations, mm-hmm. to put thousands and thousands of thousands of dollars to unseat her as they did Hillier in Mississippi.
Yeah.
Their opponent opponent priorly by 45% the last time that they ran, but mm-hmm. The time prior to that.
Mm-hmm.
But in the early 2000s, mm-hmm. this guy went from being able to collect about under $100,000 to be able to collect $800,000,
right.
which 75% of that money came from New York.
Okay.
Hmm. And then from other entities. So they are taking over the control and of African communities mm-hmm. to be able to vote in their own elected officials. That's how treacherous it is. And the only thing that he was complaining about, that he spoke up when Sir Ariel Sharon shamed the mosque mm-hmm. in Israel, and he had spoke up against the number of people who were killed because of this travesty that Ariel Sharon mm-hmm. had created. He spoke up against it, so he was targeted.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, Cynthia McKinney was targeted because of her speaking up on the question of Palestine.
That's right.
So in our community, everywhere, Zionism, the political form of Zionism
right.
that was started in 1897 mm-hmm. is a direct enemy of African people. It terrorizes us.
Now, let me give you a little historical information, this entire panel and the families that are watching, because when you talk about Africa and Israel, what you may not know of is what was called Operation Sheba, Operation Moses. These were operations where the people who are called Falasha, who you can look up.
Right. And Falasha is a negative term.
It's an old Ethiopic term that means alien resident. These people were in Ethiopia, and they were being starved in that area and in that country. And the Israeli government went in through several operations. I particularly mentioned Operation Sheba and Operation Moses, and airlifted these people back to the land of their ancestors. And the interesting thing over the historical information that came, they were singing songs. First of all, they had never seen a white Jew. They had been practicing Judaism as a culture forever, right, thousands of years. So when they came and these white people were saying they were Jews, they're like, what? And of course, what really struck them, they were singing the same song that the Israeli government, the Israeli people were singing. These Ethiopian Jews were singing some of those same songs and had the same culture, and geographically had been living thousands of miles away. So what we find, even their own DNA shows that the Levites, the people that were the biblical priests, it goes back to black people. So when we talk about categorically that the Israeli government, and then I have family who I helped raise and nurture in the Hebrew community right here in Atlanta that have repatriated into Israel, that are back, that have set up asylum. But what happens is that our biblical covenants told us to not make any alliances with the Herodians and their ancestors, because Yah hated Esau, which is the progenitor of that relationship, from his birth.
So there you go.
Jacob, there who was go. The one who was going to be the carrier of the covenant, there were enemies, but in fact, they had the same culture because they had the same father.
Remind me, if I ever do a bank robbery, not to bring Gideon along.
He might take a while.
He's spilling all the evidence. He's spilling all the evidence. He just said, did he not just say, Marlon, the superiority that God hated the other people? Did I not just hear that?
You did hear, in fact, Esau have I hated and Jacob have I loved.
Does that?
It is a biblical fact.
Okay. So that's biblical fact. Is the panel hearing this?
I am hearing this. I have a question.
But one thing that we can say, just to follow up on that one, because it's important to understand that the Ethiopian Jews were the Jews who originated in Ethiopia, who came when I'm saying they were airlifted in those on those operations that he expressed, were not allowed, were forced to convert,
to have a ritual washing,
so their even yes. their Judaism, their was their questioned. Ancient praxis,
yes,
was disputed.
Absolutely,
so they were forced to go through some kind of a, like you said, washing,
yes,
to make the, so that they were now
legitimized
through Jews who were probably less absolutely. Historically. In terms of time than yes. they were, and also they're even from my understanding, in many of the people who have migrated from the West and other places who have also reclaimed their Hebrew
heritage
culture have also been discriminated
absolutely
against
they
in the occupied Palestine also, mm-hmm. and yes. have not been allowed, after all these years of being there, have even granted them citizenship.
Absolutely. Right.
So this question of racism is clearly, this was a moral, in 1975, that was a moral victory. This moral victory was obviously for the question of apartheid. I mean, it was against Zionism, and it also was during the same period where apartheid was seen in the world as an oppressive system. These were moral victories. Unfortunately, the moral victory of apartheid stands to this day. Nobody can walk around and say that apartheid wasn't a racist system.
Right.
Unfortunately, Zionism today has got from undercover. You said 1991, it was overturned.
It was repealed.
It was repealed. But it's still, if we look at it, and we who look at it today, the eyes that we put on it today,
right.
we have to say that the moral reality of it, it really is mm-hmm. still very much racist.
Well, I mean, is that really surprising, given that they learned their imperialistic ways from
the colonies,
from America,
exactly.
from Europe, but I mean, really.
The great Satan.
But I can make the same argument and say that the whole religious concept is steeped in, just based on what Gideon said, in hatred and separatism and racism and homophobia and sexism. So, you know, it's interesting, Zabukwe, that you're saying all this. We were talking about the racism when religion in itself is steeped in racism.
Can we say, no, I was just going to say, can we say this, though?
Okay.
Even in religion, there's, I would say, even in all expressions of human philosophies, there's the notion of class struggle is there.
Mm-hmm. There's bias. Mm-hmm.
So even in our understanding of religion, there is class struggle. Some people understand the Old Testament to be literal.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Some people can understand that the Old Testament is just an allegory and a story that is told. Some people believe that the question of Christianity usurps the old teachings, that the idea of compassion for your neighbors, the questions of egalitarianism, questions of women's
egalitarianism.
Rights.
Let me stop right there. Yeah. You know, we talk about Israel. Now, you know how they persecute the Palestinians, right?
Mm-hmm. Right.
Now, this is a shout out to Mary.
I am a Palestinian, by the way.
You everything. Sure, she is.
Get that gal Zionist. You heard it.
Now, this doesn't represent all Palestinians.
Jewish.
Hold on.
Wait, a Palestinian black.
Hold on.
Jewish.
I'm about to make Benjamin Netanyahu's argument, okay?
Shout out to
Benjamin Netanyahu. She said that, you know, I said, who said this? Miriam.
Oh, okay.
You know, the Palestinian.
Yeah.
Our Palestinian friend, you ran off.
Yes, our Palestinian friend, I ran off because I would not bow down to Islam. Okay, anyway, the point that I'm making is that I said, you know what? You know, I understand the Israelis are oppressing you, this and that. So what type of government would you set up? And she's like, oh, you know, in Islam, you know, people can come to our form of governing and we will allow them, meaning Islam is going to rule, you know. This is the Sharia
law,
right?
Right.
And we're going to. So I'm kind of feeling some way about this because, you know, in one instance we say Zionism because it's in power, the American industrial complex is in charge. But you know, when I ask for solutions, you know, you got, you know, these Palestinians talk about implementing Sharia law.
Well,
regardless of human rights.
I think that we have to be careful.
I mean, that was
a Palestinian.
That's right. But she practiced a religion that states there should be a caliphate, a worldwide caliphate. The caliphate does not recognize human rights.
But I think that we have to look at what the, particularly in the beginning, and you know, there are many problems today. Many people may struggle with the question of the PLO,
right?
And where it is today,
which he was against. But go ahead.
But in the history of the PLO, you know, PLO was a secular organization, mm-hmm. you know, and it had it was a
PLO is Palestinian Liberation Organization. Okay,
and the PLO founded, I think, in 1960
is it after?
Six
or five? Okay,
somewhere around there.
Right.
But Yasser Arafat came from Al-Fayed, which was a secular socialist organization. Mm-hmm. But it was only one of the members of the PLO. The PLO had religious organizations and all other kinds. It was a front. It was a political front of Palestinian organizations, and they took a secular position on trying to take power, even though many of them were religious. And that's so I don't think that the resistance, you know, in later years, we've seen a shift after the PLO seemed to have made some compromises that the people thought were not in the best interest,
yeah.
mm-hmm.
that you've seen Hezbollah and other more religious oriented organizations become more dominant in the struggle against Zionism in Israel. So I think that it clearly, that even now, many of the, if you see, there is a somewhat of a shift back to the struggle of knowing to be more secular.
Yeah, well,
what I'm saying. But for sure, the struggle against Zionism is not simply some kind of religious manifestation. And
I think you were about to let Kevin respond just a minute ago.
Right.
I'm no, sorry. That, I got cut you off.
That's all right. That's all right. Actually, the time is going really fast, so yeah, I want to make. Okay. There's a lot I want to say, but you know, one of the things that I wanted to bring up, because one of the things you stated was that that Zionism as a political force. Mm-hmm. I want to clarify that as a political force has right. always been against the interest of African people, right? Mm-hmm. And I was recently made aware by actually one of the shows that I listened to on WRFG that you did of the role Zionism played in weakening the Black Power movement here in the United States, specifically right here in Atlanta, the SNCC, the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee. And I was wondering, because I do think this is relevant for the discussion of the Black Lives Matter movement today, for the discussion of all the movements going on today, I was hoping that you could bring some of that to yes. to the discussion and explain some of that so that we can kind of process that with movements today.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Are you asking me to?
Yeah.
Well, the question is that And this struggle, and in the struggle of the civil rights struggle and many other struggles of African people, at many points there's been people who are not African, non-African, who have contributed financially to these movements.
Okay.
Many of them for many different reasons. Of course, in the civil rights movement, because many people who are Jewish and had also been terrorized by white supremacy here in the United States. Were certainly right. interested in the civil rights movement for African mm-hmm. people. They contributed largely, some Zionists, I'm sure some non-Zionists. But one of the things that happened within the, as the civil rights movement morphed into the Black Power movement and the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee started to examine not only the imperialist policies of the United States, they looked at the question of Vietnam, we know that. They also looked at some point at the question of Palestine. Right. As soon as they wrote a paper, somehow that paper ended up in the hands of some of the folks of in the Zionist community. Immediately pulled money out of the SNCC movement and helped to divide those who. So there was this discussion. It's been this ongoing struggle of whether or not support of Palestine or support of Israel, and it's been a moral dilemma that has been coming up on several different occasions inside of the African community. So we're looking at a question of even funding now. When we look at something like the Black Lives Movement, we see many of the organizations are also getting money from different funders, some of them who have not done good things in Africa, and are essentially imperialists.
You know, okay.
And we have to be careful that we don't end up in the same situation where our good movements are undermined by
corruption.
Finances that can easily be pulled. And we can't be, I think it's a mistake for us to be reliant on those sources.
Right.
Now, well, you know, our time is winding down. Marlon and Vincent, I mean, you guys jump in here so that we can get a full body of the thought as we deal with this Zionist concept.
Well, I was a little shocked to learn, since we're talking about civil rights and stuff, that MLK was a supporter of the Zionist movement. Right. So that was pretty shocking to me.
Well, it's I don't want to take over. Not only, the question at Martin Luther King, you go back to even Marcus Garvey, was not an anti-Zionist. The question of the legitimacy of Zionism was mistaken by a lot of our leaders, unfortunately, because of the association not only with the religion but also with what happened prior to 1948. The Holocaust
was
used as a
springboard.
Yeah, it was used as the excuse.
Right.
It was, listen, these people have been tortured. These people have been killed, not by mm-hmm. Palestinians, but mm-hmm. by Germans.
Yeah.
So why didn't they give them some land in Germany? I don't understand why the Palestinians.
Right. That was on the table at one point.
Yeah, but the question. Of the Holocaust and the propaganda and people's religious beliefs have been an impediment for them to understand the question of political Zionism as a colonial process, as a settler colonial process. Much like, and let's not be confused, that this is a settler project. There is still not a there's still not a proper understanding by the masses of the people that we, I think you refer to DDON, a proper understanding that this is the indigenous people's land that has been stolen, sure. And there has right. been no real real admission that
right.
the enslavement of African people mm-hmm. and the stealing of indigenous people's land
right.
is a moral dilemma, and many of us applaud the cowboys. In fact, Africans who have been enslaved in this country went off and were not allowed to arm themselves, and after they helped gain their own freedom in the war. In the so-called Civil War, when we
right.
picked up guns and were able to change the results of that movement,
right.
we were disarmed, right. and until we were allowed to join them again to go kill indigenous people
right.
in the western part of this country.
Right.
So our African confliction around imperialism mm-hmm. is a very important struggle that we have to
So there's one thing that I think that strikes me as relevant here, which is what kind of resistance are we seeing today? Because the conflict between Israel and Palestine has been going on forever, and it's
right.
often characterized as a conflict between peoples, mm-hmm. right? Like, there's Israelis and there's Palestinians, and they hate
right.
each other,
mm-hmm.
and they'll just never stop hating each other. They're constantly at war. Mm-hmm. And I think a better way to understand it is Zionism is an ideology of an elite, a particular elite.
That's right. Yeah.
Right.
That controls a government, that controls a network of resources
mm-hmm.
globally.
Mm-hmm.
And this force is maintaining an occupation that harms both Israeli Jews, you know, Ethiopian and otherwise,
mm-hmm.
And the Palestinians. And so there's an organization that's been taking action recently that actively resists this called Anarchists Against the Wall.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a coalition of Israeli Jews and Palestinians
mm-hmm.
that work together to physically destroy the wall that
mm-hmm.
separates people within, you know, occupied Israel.
How can people
occupied
contact
Palestine?
How can people contact that?
There's
group?
A website if you look for Anarchists Against the Wall.
Mm-hmm.
But
mm-hmm.
but the point is by attacking the wall materially together,
mm-hmm.
they're showing a strong message that this is not a question of ethnicity,
mm-hmm.
this is not a question of religion.
Mm-hmm.
It's a question of an elite nationalist force
mm-hmm.
trying to pit people against each other who
mm-hmm.
have more in common than they have against each
now,
other.
Now, let me just say this. I went through the Aliyah process, but I was rejected by this country. They wouldn't let me in. And I went in a mindset of not humility. I went in thinking...
You were rejected by Israel?
Absolutely.
Okay.
They wrote me a letter. We definitely ain't going to let you up in here, homie. You know?
Maybe it's because you're confused that you're a Palestinian.
Oh,
black Jew Zionist.
Thank you. That was good. Right, just like
you said it.
Right, just like he's an anarchist, socialist, communist, capitalist, nationalist, spiritualist.
Well, you know, as a Hebrew,
I'd
be your Hebrew. You know, it's a reality, however, that the hatred that my beloved brother spoke of so eloquently in a wealth of information is legitimate. It exists. The colonists still, the political agenda that's taken over the Zionist concept is a real agenda. It is run by the elite group that are part of the illuminated ones, the corporations that run the earth, and they have a concept of control, destroy, and manipulation.
All right.
Okay.
All right, y'all, thank you for tuning in. we are going to go internet and mobile until we find us a new place.
Oh, yes.
Could be
yeah.
soon.
Could be soon.
We're
yeah.
waiting on a place, but we will still be on YouTube, right?
We'll still be on Facebook, so, you know, check us out. We're going to go mobile, and until we find a place, we'll...
And we want to thank you all for your work. So for
thank you. Thank you, Pat.
Thank you.
Thank you, Pat.
Hey, tell me a show on WRG. Okay.
It's Revolutionary African Perspectives on Monday nights from 7 to 8 p.m. on 89.3 or WRFG.org. You can listen in online.
Big ups to RFG, baby.
Tell your show, too. Your
Just Peace comes on right before Revolutionary African Perspectives. So that's 6 to 7.
Double dose.
That's right. Right.
Yeah. This is our final broadcast from Comcast Channel 25.
This is it.
Live.
They're
going dead.
Thank you
this.
For tuning in. We really appreciate you. Join us on YouTube, The Arena Uncensored. We filming on word. Location, baby.
Yes,
The Arena Uncensored, all one
right.
word.
I think we are.
Free movement.
Peace.
Free movement.
Give him his medication.